Pierce, we are at the Museum of Tolerance and we'll be checking out the Anne Frank exhibit. We are at the Museum of Tolerance. Our next stop is the Museum of Tolerance and we'll be checking out the Anne Frank exhibit.
How is this our next stop?
Our next stop is the Museum of Tolerance.
Want to do a hello Blockaneer one more time?
Hello Blockaneers, we are at the Museum of Tolerance.
Oh, I mean with the whole thing.
Hello Blockaneers, we are at the Museum of Tolerance and we will... Hello Blockaneers, we are at the Museum of Tolerance and we'll be checking out the Anne Frank exhibit.
Since you see some toys here, okay, that some of the children.
I like it. That's cute.
Jews are allowed. Oasis is usually... I expect you will be rather surprised at the fact that
9 out of 10 times I can assure that you will be. Sunday, July 5th, 1994
is not at all bad. They were scared, for my mother talked as much as I, probably more, and what can one do?
It was incurable chatterbox. But in the third...
But first the war, then the capitulation, followed by the arrival of the Germans. Anti-Jewish decrees followed each other in quick succession, so we could not do this, and we were forbidden to do that. But life went on in spite of it all. Our freedom was strictly limited. Yet, things were still bearable. Dear Granny and dear everyone, today Mommy and I went into town to buy a coat for me. A gray one and a hat to go with it. I think it's very beautiful. Dear Juanita, I did receive your letter and want to answer you as quick as possible. We have little work at home. I include a postcard from Amsterdam and shall continue to do that. In case you and Betty get a photo, do send a copy as I am curious to know how you look. My birthday is the 12th of June. Kindly let me know yours. Hoping to hear from you, I remain your Dutch friend, Annelise Marie Frank.
April 20th, very busy, as I have to work for school at home too, or through Belgium and France.
Otto Frank was urgently considering his options. Although his wife's brothers had made their way to the U.S. and were living in Boston, Massachusetts.
Friday, June 12th, I woke up at 6 o'clock, and no wonder, it was my birthday. But of course, I was not allowed to get up at that hour, so I had to control my curiosity until 6:45. Then I could bear it no longer, and went into the dining room where I received a warm welcome from Mortier, the cat. Soon after 7, I went to Mommy and Daddy, and then to the sitting room to undo my presents. The first to greet me was Monday, June 15th, 1942. I had my birthday party on Sunday afternoon. We watched a film, The Lighthouse Keeper, with Rin Tin Tin, which my school... Saturday, June 20th, 1942. It's an odd idea for someone like me to keep a diary. Not only because I've never done so before, but because it seems to me that neither I, nor for that matter, anyone else, will be interested in the unbosoming of a group. When we walked across our little square together a few days ago, Daddy began to talk about us going into hiding. I asked him why on earth he was beginning to talk about it, and not wait until they come to fetch us. But Daddy, when would it be? He spoke so seriously that I grew very anxious. That was all. May the fulfillment of these somber words remain far distant yet. The call-up was not for Daddy, but for her. I was more frightened than ever and began to cry. Margot is 16. Would they really take girls of that age away alone? But thank goodness she won't go. Mommy said so herself. And that must be what Daddy meant when he talked about us going to hiding. Margot and I began to pack some of our most vital belongings into a school satchel. The first thing I carried was a diary. Pathetic looks from people. You could see by their faces how sorry they were that they couldn't offer us a lift. The gaudy yellow star spoke for itself. As possible, had been sent away when they were sufficiently ready for us. The hiding place itself would be in the building where Daddy has his office. Daddy didn't have many people working for him. Mr. Crawler, Cope House, Meep, and Ellie Vossen, who all knew of our arrival. Peter arrived, the Von Don's son. Not 16 yet, a rather soft, shy, gawky youth. Can't expect... Dear Kitty, so much has happened. It is just as if the whole world has turned upside down. Yes, I'm still alive indeed, but don't ask where or how. Our little room looked very bare at first, with nothing on the walls. But thanks to Daddy, who had brought my film star collection and picture postcards on beforehand, I have transformed the walls into one gigantic picture. This makes it look much more cheerful. Countless friends and acquaintances have gone into a terrible fate. Evening after evening, the green and gray army lorries trundle past. The Germans ring at every front door to inquire if there are any Jews living in the house. If there are, then the whole family has to go at once. I often see rows of good, innocent people accompanied by crying children walking on and on in the charge of a couple of these chaps, bullied and knocked about until they almost drop. Dear Kitty, we have to whisper and tread lightly during the day, otherwise the people in the warehouse might hear us. We pass the time in all sorts of crazy ways. Asking riddles, physical training in the dark, talking English and French, criticizing books. But after a while, everything gets boring. Very childish, but you don't know what it's like. The anti-aircraft guns roar so loudly that you can't hear yourself speak. I see the eight of us with our secret annex as if we were a little piece of blue heaven, surrounded by heavy black rain clouds. We all look down below where people are fighting each other. We look up above where it is quiet and beautiful, and meanwhile we are cut off by the great dark mass. It tries to crush us, but cannot do so yet. I can only cry and implore. Oh, if only the black circle could recede and open the way for us. Yesterday evening, before I fell asleep, who should suddenly appear before my eyes but Lise. Clothed in rags, her face thin and worn. Her eyes were very big, and she looked so sadly and reproachfully at me that I could read in her eyes. Oh, Anne, why have you deserted me? Help, oh, help me, rescue me from this hell. And I cannot help her, I can only look on. Why should I be chosen to live and she probably to die? Believe me, if you've been shut up for a year and a half, it can get too much for you some days. Cycling, dancing, whistling, looking out into the world, feeling young. To know that I'm free, that's what I long for. Whenever I go upstairs now, I keep on hoping that I shall see him. Because my life now has an object and I have something to look forward to, everything has become more pleasant. Mommy doesn't like it much. She looks at me so queerly every time I go into Peter's little room. If I come downstairs from there, she asks me where I've been. I simply can't bear it, and I think it's horrible. Both of us looked at the glorious blue of the sky, the bare chestnut tree on whose branches little raindrops shone, at the seagulls and other birds that looked like silver in the sun. We breathed the fresh air, looked outside, and both felt that the spell should not be broken by words. Volkstein, a member of parliament, was speaking on the Dutch news from London, and he said that they ought to make a collection of diaries and letters after the war. Just imagine how interesting it would be if I were to publish a romance of the secret annex. The title alone would be enough to make people think it was a detective story. But seriously, it would seem quite funny 10 years after the war if we Jews were to tell how we lived and what we ate and talked about here. I must have something besides a husband and children, something that I can devote myself to. I want to go on living even after my death. And that's why I'm so grateful to God for having given me this gift, which I can use to develop myself and write, to express all that's inside me. But, and that's a big question, will I ever be able to write something great? Will I ever become a journalist or a writer? Then, a 11:15, a bustle and noise downstairs. Footsteps in the house, in the private office, kitchen. Then a rattling of the swinging cupboard. This moment was indescribable. Now we are lost, I said, and I could see us all being taken away by the Gestapo that night. Twice they rattled the cupboard. Then there was nothing. The footsteps withdrew. We were saved thus far. We have been pointedly reminded that we are in hiding, that we are Jews in chains without any rights but with 1,000 duties. Who has made us Jews different from all other people? Who has allowed us to suffer so terribly up till now? It is God that has made us as we are. But it will be God, too, who will raise us up again. If we bear all this suffering, and if there are still Jews left when it is over, then Jews, instead of being doomed, will be held up as an example. Who knows? It might even be our religion, from which the world and all the peoples learn good. And for that reason, and that reason only, do we have to suffer now. Be brave. God has never deserted our people. For every girl when she receives her first kiss, well, then it is just as important for me too. How it came about so suddenly, I don't know. But before we went downstairs, he kissed me. Through my hair, half on my left cheek, half on my ear. I tore downstairs without looking around. "This is D-Day," came the announcement over the English news. "The invasion has begun." According to German news, English parachute troops have landed on the French coast. Great commotion in the secret annex. With the long-awaited liberation that has been talked of so much, but which still seems too wonderful, too much like a fairy tale ever come true, could we be granted victory this year, 1944? We don't know yet, but hope is revived within us. It gives us fresh courage and makes us strong again. Anyone who claims that the older ones have a more difficult time doesn't realize to what extent our problems weigh down on us. That's the difficulty in times like these. Ideals, dreams, and cherished hopes rise within us, only to be shattered. It's really a wonder that I haven't dropped all my ideals. Yet I keep them, because I still believe that people are really good at heart. I see the world gradually being turned into a wilderness. I hear the ever-approaching thunder, which will destroy us too. I can feel the sufferings of millions, and yet if I look up into the heavens, it will all come right. That this cruelty too will end, and that peace and tranquility will return again.
On August 4th, 1944, Gestapo agents raided the secret annex after receiving a tip from a Dutch citizen or citizens who had information that the Franks and the others were in hiding. To this day, their betrayer or betrayers have never been identified, but many Dutch Jews were similarly turned in to the Nazis by their own neighbors during the occupation. After arresting Anne Frank and the others in the secret annex, an SS officer dumped out a briefcase containing Anne's diary and then filled it with the Franks' valuables. Anne was so scared, she didn't even glance at her diary on the floor. They were taken to Gestapo headquarters and then sent by passenger train to the Westerbork transit camp. It was a beautiful day. Otto recalled later, "We were together again and had been given a little food for the journey." The Franks were crowded into a cattle car with more than 60 people, so they could only sit or stand. There was no light or sanitation, and hardly any food or water. After three grueling days, they arrived at Auschwitz. The men and women were separated, and the SS decided who would go to the gas chambers right away. Most men Otto's age were gassed. Otto turned for a last glimpse of his family. He saw Margot and later told his surviving relatives, "I shall remember the look in Margot's eyes all my life."
Hello. Anne, Margot, and Mrs. Frank were sent to Block 29. Many became numb to the horrors around them, but one eyewitness recalled Anne crying when she saw gypsy women and Hungarian children headed to the gas chambers. Anne, Margot, and Mrs. Frank stayed close, trying to comfort each other under frightening conditions. When called for a work group at another camp, Mrs. Frank and Margot stayed back with Anne because she was suffering from scabies. Had they gone, they probably would have survived. Otto was spared the gas chamber, but working and living conditions were brutal to his camp. Mr. von Pelz died in the gas chamber after only a few weeks. By November, Otto's morale began to give way after the beatings and hard labor. It was Sunday morning, and I said, I can't get up. October 28th, four, Anne and Margot were taken to Bergen-Belsen, while their mother remained at Auschwitz. In December, Anne and Margot celebrated Hanukkah with Lien and Jani Brillschlipper, with potato peels and Yiddish songs. They imagined what they would do if they ever got home. Anne suggested, we'll have a party, a celebratory meal at Dikker & Thies, one of Amsterdam's most expensive restaurants. For a little while, they were almost happy, but living conditions at the camp were so miserable that Anne asked, why do they want us to live like animals? Jani answered, because they are man-eating wild animals themselves. A typhus epidemic was raging through the Bergen-Belsen camp, and soon Margot and Anne got sick. Hanneli, Anne's best childhood friend, was in a privileged transport camp at Bergen-Belsen right next to Anne's camp. She threw a parcel of food she'd received from the Red Cross over to her sick and starving friend, but another woman snatched it away. Hanneli threw a second parcel, and Anne caught it that time, but she never heard from Anne again. Lien recalls that when she and Jani went to visit Anne and Margot that March, they weren't in the barrack anymore. We found them in the sick house. We told them they mustn't stay there because whenever you gave up hope, the end was near. Anne said, here we can both lie on one bunk. We are together, and it's peaceful. Margot could only whisper. She had a high fever. The next day, we went to visit them again. Margot had fallen out of the bunk and was barely conscious. Anne had a fever too. She was friendly and sweet. She said, Margot will sleep well, and when she sleeps, I won't need to get up again. A few days later, we found their bunk empty. We knew what that meant. We found them behind the barrack, wrapped their thin bodies in a blanket, and carried them to a mass grave. That was all we could do for them. Anne and Margot died just weeks before the camp was liberated. Otto was the only survivor from the secret annex. After his camp was liberated, he wrote to his family in Switzerland, I'm healthy and in good spirits. I do not know where Edith and the children are.
Simon felt a special affinity to
das Parkgebäude an der Pracht.
Ein einfaches Kind, 14-jährig.
Young people write to me, asking questions. Many are writing a diary themselves, calling their diary Anna's diary. They write to Anna as Anna wrote to Kitty. And so, especially in the time of adolescence, they get a lot of confidence and hope for their lives in reading about Anna.
Who's Kitty?
But I'm taller and older. It's 1, 2, 3.
Oh, what's your name? There's a reflection.
1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. That's it. 1, 2, 3. I'm much bigger. And
pages that people can read about her.
Okay. Look.
He left the diary with me at night in a briefcase next to my bed. I had promised her never to look in. I never did. When I returned, not come back, me gave me the diary, which had been saved by, I should say, the girl. I was very much surprised and critical. It was quite a different manner than I had known of my daughter. She never really showed this kind of inner feeling. She talked about many things in the diary. And my conclusion is, as I had...
1947, 4 years later, an English translation was released with a foreword by Eleanor Roosevelt.
Ah, no, I think cancel. Yeah.
You know why? I can't put them. But I can't.
Go, no, no. Let's go. No.
That's it, no?
Hey,
Mama. Take a picture, passport.